Hey, Gary Hoover here. You know, everybody seems to be talking about jobs these days. We need more jobs. America needs more jobs. How do we get more jobs? Do this, do that. No, don't do this, don't do that. Okay? I agree. Jobs are important. But like so many things, it strikes me most of what I hear, people aren't really thinking or thinking deeply about some of this stuff. So the first thing, I got two thoughts I want to give you about jobs today. One is about share. And one is about big versus small business. So talking about share, you know, if I'm going into an industry, or I'm going to start a company, or I'm just trying to analyze an industry, buy stock in it, go to work for it, whatever, I want to know a couple things. I want to know, is the total market growing or shrinking? So like the demand here, okay, if it's grown at zero, or say it's grown at 1% a year, or it's grown at 2% a year, or 3%. So this line is growth in the total market. And so maybe cigarettes are a shrinking market, at least in the United States. I think they are, in terms of total demand. On the other hand, the demand for pad computers is booming over here somewhere. So that's one question. The other question I want to think about is, what's my share doing? Am I gaining or losing share? Because I could be, you know, losing 10% of my share every year, going from 60% to 54% would be a 10% loss from 60, would be down 6 points, or down 20%, or down 30%, or I'd be gaining share. So like in tablet PCs, probably Lenovo and Toshiba, which just introduced their first tablet PCs, are gaining share from zero to go up. Anyhow, and I want to know that because if I am in a market that's booming, tablet PCs, and I'm also gaining share, I'm out in this quadrant here, which is just great, you know? It's growing and I'm growing share. So if it's growing 10% a year and my share is growing 10% a year, then my total revenue is going to be growing like 20% or so a year because it like compounds. On the other hand, if it's a shrinking market and I'm losing share, like I'm a cigarette maker and I sell a smaller share of all the cigarettes sold in America every year, and there are less cigarettes sold every year, that's like the dark era, you know? No, I don't want to be there. There's a line that runs like this above which my revenues are growing. So in other words, if the total market is going down, say it's going down 2% a year, but I'm gaining share. Like in the old days, it was Marlboro was booming even when cigarettes weren't growing that much. Well, then I can, if my share is growing faster than 2% a year, say my share is growing 8% a year, then I'm out here. I'm on the good side of that line. I am growing my revenue. And likewise, I could be in a market that's booming, like say smartphones, and yet I could be losing share. I think maybe BlackBerry is last I looked. Maybe Motorola, I'm not sure. But there are people losing share. If somebody's gaining share, somebody's losing share. So there are people down here in a booming market that are losing share, but they're still, their revenue's growing, right? And if you're on this side of the line, then you're shrinking. So understanding, I hope I didn't make it too complex. It's pretty straightforward. Is the market growing or not? Is my share growing or not? And so, and that's just basic thinking about any kind of revenue or growth kind of idea. I'm sure we could look at biology or all sorts of other things, similar ideas. Well, is anybody asking what is the growth in world jobs and what is our share? Because if the total world is not creating jobs, that's a different problem from if it's just the U.S. If the world's creating 1 billion jobs a year and we're losing jobs, then it's a share problem. On the other hand, if the world isn't creating jobs, it's a different issue. And the only way to, because I think if we're going to create, I think they say we need 20 million jobs by 2020 or whatever to get our economy back on track. Whatever the number is, if we're going to do that, we either need to be gaining a lot of share or the world market's got to be growing. And if the world total job creation is just booming, we can actually have loss of share, and that actually would be expected. When you've got so much China and India, the two most populous countries on Earth, both having economies racing along, if that continues in Brazil and Indonesia are not far behind them, and if that continues, then you would expect the United States over the next 30, 40, 50, 100, 200 years will have a smaller share of the global economy. That, if anything, that makes it more important than ever that we make sure the globe total grows. And the U.S. is in a wonderful position to play a role in that because we are such a central thing. I saw the other day, what is it, in the next, I think they said 5 years, China's going to need 5,000 commercial aircraft, jetliners. You think that's not good news for Boeing? We can get into the issues about where do you make them, where do you make the parts, taxes, all the issues that go into global trade-offs. But I've tried to look for data on total global job creation. I haven't found much. Now, it's very difficult for people to put all that together because, you know, a lot of countries, there are no jobs, or we don't know who created jobs, and they don't have the census bureaus like we do in Europe and Japan, Australia, and, you know, there are places, very sophisticated data collection systems. So it can be tricky, and I have found there's a World Labor Organization related to the UN and all that, and they publish labor statistics. I got some of those books on the way to me now. But I would urge us to start thinking in terms of the world and ourselves and our share in it. Because if the world ain't cooking, we ain't gonna cook either. It is just too tightly integrated, Dave. The other idea about jobs is you hear this stuff all the time, or at least I do, all the jobs in America created by small businesses. There are the overwhelming share of the jobs in America created by, so let's support small businesses. Let's tax those big businesses to death and lower the taxes on small businesses. At least you hear that kind of stuff a fair amount. And I'm out talking about entrepreneurship and stuff, so maybe I'm just where it's going around. But here's the thing. Now, all I got to find so far, I've found the data sources. I haven't done all the digging yet. This is job creation in the United States from 1990 to 2003. So this is, 14 years of job creation, or 13 years between them. And it's the totals, and that's a pretty good long span. I'd rather say 20, 30, 40 years, pretty good span. And it was a pretty good era for America, the 90s. And so what we have is companies that had less than 20 employees had a net job creation of 18 million jobs, and companies of 20 to 500 employees, or 499 actually, created 3 million jobs, and companies of 500 or more employees created 1.4 million jobs. Anyway, okay, so that's where you get these headlines. Oh, all the jobs are created by small businesses, right? And this is what we call net job creation. You hire somebody, you lay off somebody, how many net? So it does matter. But what's interesting to me is what they call gross job creation, so, or let's say gains and losses. So how many jobs were actually, how many new people were hired by these outfits? Well, roughly, the little outfits hired 70 million and laid off 52 million. So there's a lot of churn there. And especially companies that are 1 to 6 years old, 5 years old, seem to really drop them off. In the next category, they created 73 million and laid off 70. And the next, the big guys, or relatively big guys, I'd like to see 5,000 plus employers, the giants of American industry, they hired 95 million and 95.4, and they lost 94 million jobs. Well, yeah, this is interesting, but let's focus on this. Who created most of the jobs in America during that time period? 238 million, something like that. Yeah, I understand. They lost as many as they gained at these big companies. But the biggest single chunk were large companies creating new jobs. And what you got to have going on in a lot of cases is one industry's going down while another's rising up. You know, home building is off, but making jets for China is up. You know, Caterpillar is doing fine, UPS is doing fine, but GM, Ford, and Chrysler are laying people off. Or within an industry, GM, Ford, and Chrysler are laying people off. Honda, Toyota, BMW, all those dudes are hiring people, even here in the United States. And so my thing is, I'm much more interested in this number. Now, if we can figure out ways to reduce this, but a lot of that's just natural and going to happen. But I don't know that it has to happen just with big companies. I don't think this happens just because they're big. And there are studies have been done, and I've started reading a bunch of them, that it's all about the age of the company. And there it's clear, startups do create jobs. And when you go from zero employees to anybody, you add jobs. A lot of those jobs are lost back within a few years, but there's no question early stage startups do create jobs, but are they lasting jobs? And then there's some indication, one study I was looking at, that companies like 25 years old and older, they have net job creation. The really older companies, well-established companies. I want to look at a lot more data. It was just a little bit of data, and it was implied that, well, that really goes up and down with the economy. Well, so do these numbers, but the thing is, for us to say, oh, big companies don't matter, it's just nonsense. And where do these small companies, where do they get their business? Where do they get their revenue? A great Austin company called Bizarre Voice, BazarVoice, just filed to go public. They provide ratings and reviews and other services online for big e-commerce companies, for HomeDepot.com, Walmart.com, and everything. Wonderful company, founded and led by a wonderful entrepreneur, Brett Hurt, friend of mine. And their business has got to be like 90-95% Fortune 500 companies. He started with nothing 6 years ago, and he now has over 700 employees. He is a job creator. He is one of our superstars, he and his company, Bizarre Voice. They are nothing. They don't exist without General Motors and Procter & Gamble and Home Depot or, you know, whoever you want to pick. To try to focus on, and I think, when I think, why does this go on? It's politics. It's, you got a bunch of friends of small business groups and so on. Say, oh yeah, we're startup groups. And I understand that. I'm an entrepreneur. I can write a book about how we need better financing systems for startups and things we should do better. And I don't know, maybe lower the taxes on investment in startups. That, man, just be careful. Be careful. We need everybody. We need, and I think maybe what we really need isn't big companies or small companies, old companies or young companies. We need growth companies. We need companies that are innovating and finding cool new things to do and are swimming in new waters, expanding markets. We need more Apples, man. We need more Target's a great company. Container Store. Well, anyway. Not for today, but the bottom line is, you hear all this stuff about jobs, stop and think. Think about the U.S. and how it fits into the world, and also think about the role of all sizes and types of employers and whether they're really contributing to the growth of our economy and the world's economy or not. That's enough for today. This is Gary Hoover. I'll see you later.